Welcome, bienvenue. This is panel 7 on In the Theatre, Dans le Théâtre. And I am Paul Moore from Ryerson University in Toronto. And I'm very excited about this panel. Overlaps with my own research very much in ways that I'm eager to learn from all of the panelists. I'll quickly introduce the three panelists and just a 10-second synopsis with their title. And then each of them will introduce their point for just a minute or two. And then they'll start with questions to each other. And then we'll open it up to questions to others as best I can. And Valentine is going to voice some of the questions en français, and we will make do and make best use of our time. First of all, Céline Plouquet. She is a doctoral candidate at Université de Paris 8, Saint-Denis. And her paper is on musicians in Parisian cinema programs, 1906 to 1914. And the top level point that I took away from her synopsis is that in fact, the musicians in pre-World War I Parisian cinemas became stars in and of themselves in a much earlier time than we might have known. And the idea of naming a musician as a star of the program is what she's partly focusing on here. All three of these papers are really about the intermediality of the program and the performance and the blend between what's happening in the theater and what's happening on the screen as a multimedia performance altogether. For example, second paper by Mario Slugan, he is a lecturer at Queen Mary University of London, and he is looking at early fictional narrators of where the lecturer accompanying the film, the bonaventure accompanying the film is actually a fictional narrator of films. And he's looking there at Burton Holmes, who I had only thought of as a travel lecturer, but he's recovered ways that there's a fictional voice to Burton Holmes' travel lectures and other things there. Gwendolyn Waltz is a third paper I found fascinating. She is a theater historian based in Philadelphia, specializing in multimedia production, where film is combined with extra filmic elements in the theater. She's focused in this paper on the Edison Trust banning of filmed vaudeville specialties. And so suddenly in 1908, there's an end to vaudeville performers filming their specialty acts. And she's traced ways that independent film producers begin to collaborate with vaudeville acts in order to be able to recirculate in the Trust era, recirculate their filmed vaudeville as part of the specialty. And I am used to thinking of the motion picture specialty as the thing between the vaudeville acts rather than the vaudeville act itself. So I will hand it over to Céline and then Mario and Gwendolyn to just say a little bit more in their own words and to ask questions of each other, and we'll open it up for to all of you attending today. Céline.
Can I speak in French? Ok, je serai plus à l'aise en français. D'abord, je voulais vous remercier pour cette présentation et puis vous remercier de m'avoir invité à partager mes recherches. Cette présentation que j'ai faite, j'ai tenu en fait à présenter un travail de longue haleine sur la présentation des programmes de salles de cinéma qui sont conservés à la Bibliothèque historique de la ville de Paris et qui a un fond avec énormément de documents et qui est assez complexe à saisir tant par son hétérogénéité que par les manques aussi qu'on a dans ce fonds-là. Et je me suis attachée plus particulièrement à essayer de repérer toutes les occurrences sur la musique dans ces programmes de salles de cinéma. J'ai trouvé donc deux types d'informations. Une première information sur la valorisation de la musique au sein de la séance. Quel type de musique pouvait être joué pendant la séance, mais pas pendant les projections, plutôt en interlude en fait. Et ensuite, et là c'est ce dont je parle dans l'intervention que je vous ai présentée ici, c'est les mentions des musiciens avec leur nom dans ces programmes et qui permet en fait déjà de voir l'installation d'une pratique dès la sédentarisation du cinéma qui est la pratique d'accompagnement effectuée par un orchestre et qui permet aussi de voir non pas un processus de professionnalisation mais plutôt moi j'appelle ça un processus de spécialisation des musiciens donc qui vont se spécialiser dans l'accompagnement de salles de projection dans les salles de cinéma parisiennes. Voilà.
Et Mario?
Yeah, I can continue with my just. I mean, it's really going to be a brief summary. Essentially, just to kind of repeat three general points that I was trying to make. The first of which I guess is the least controversial. And that is essentially that kind of lecture performance can be easily should be easily better understood as kind of a intermedial text, hybrid text, rather than kind of thinking about these things somehow external to the, let's say, either running of the film or to the lecture. The second point, which might be a bit more controversial, is that if we, let's say, take seriously some kind of definitions of fictions, which are more from the field of philosophical aesthetics, and if we think about these things, if we think of fictions in terms of what kind of, forms of imaginings, in the sense that you're supposed to imagine something as an audience, then we can also think about these kind of travelogues, specifically Burton Holmes' travelogues, as instances of this kind of text, which do provide these mandates for imaginings, specifically due to specific uses of kind of deictical markers and the uses of kind of present tense and similar linguistic factors. And then, as a kind of logical consequence stemming out of this, is that we can identify, we think about these things as fiction or not, in this kind of those earlier debates with by Gunning and Godreau, whether it is a kind of a matter of who introduced this, whether it's with the introduction of cinema, whether it's later with the kind of a biograph, for instance. So this is a kind of a proposal that you can identify it even earlier, and you don't even have to go, you don't have to tell whether something is, let's say, a narrative film. You can identify these things even earlier. So that would be in short. Thanks.
And Gwendolyn?
I would like to say a few words about the process of researching. When I submitted my proposal, like many of you, I had planned a research trip that was canceled because of the pandemic. The emphasis of my presentation changed as I made discoveries in online newspapers and journals that I probably would not have examined if I'd been able to leave my house, particularly regarding a number of aha moments about the professional relationships of the people I discuss. Additionally, the method of sharing our conference presentations as online objects to access individually, whenever, and in whatever order we please, provided a chance for me to experiment with an interactive presentation format with links to internet materials layered with the text and images of my PowerPoint document, which each of you can choose to experience or not. I'm a firm believer that obstacles bring about serendipitous opportunities that often are more interesting than the direction we plan to take. And I wish to encourage those of you who are just beginning your explorations of film-related topics to have patience with setbacks and unexpected detours. Allow yourself the time and space to embrace redirection and the altered viewpoints it brings to your work.
So thank you to all three. There are already many questions waiting in the chat, but if any of you had something as a first question to each other, please do.
I had a question for each of my fellow panelists. Céline, one of my mother's relatives was a pianist for silent film, so as I watched your presentation, I thought about people like her discovering a whole new profession. You say that Paul Fauché composed operettas and songs. In any of the programs, was there evidence that he composed film accompaniments as well?
Alors, merci beaucoup pour cette question. En fait, dans les programmes, il y a très peu de mentions, surtout avant la guerre, il y a très peu de mentions de morceaux qui ont accompagné les films. Paul Fauché, là, c'est vrai que vous me posez une colle. Je ne suis pas certaine qu'il ait composé des accompagnements pour des films. Il faudrait que je vérifie. Mais effectivement, en dehors de Paul Fauché, ensuite, pendant les années 20, j'ai découvert que de nombreux chefs d'orchestre qui étaient de plus en plus renommés se sont mis à composer surtout des musiques incidentales pour accompagner les films. Donc, pas forcément une partition pour un film, mais plutôt, par exemple, ils allaient composer un morceau qui allait s'appeler « Tempête » pour accompagner des scènes de tempête ou des scènes de guerre, ou alors un morceau qui allait s'appeler « Romance » pour accompagner une scène d'amour. Voilà. Mais concernant Paul Fauché, là, c'est vrai que je ne l'ai pas en tête. Je ne suis pas certaine.
I'm waiting for the translation.
Thank you.
Thank you. If everybody's shy, I can ask my question for Mario. I enjoyed your examination of Burton Holmes' travel lectures as a type of early fictional motion picture narrative. And I'm curious whether this approach had precedence. Have you compared his presentation style to those of other lecturers who used visual media, including magic lanterns and panoramas, as well as those who merely lectured orally?
Thanks for the question. Well, I mean, yeah, that's the thing. I mean, it seems that Burton Holmes is here a bit of an outlier in terms of, you know, this particular language. There were, other presentation styles which would not, which would not allow you to make this kind of claims about invitations of feeling oneself present in this, in the travel. There were far more, for instance, I have to repeat, it really draws much on Altman's work, how, for instance, Stoddard, for instance, had a completely different type of presentation style, which was really kind of a factual matter of fact, you know, this is how this place looks like, bam, 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 bam. Mm-hmm. Where as opposed to, you know, Holmes, which would be like, ooh, you know, here we are, look on your left, look on your right, walk here, this kind of, these are more clearly, sort of pure forms of purely kind of a factual presentation and purely, let's say, this kind of a imagination inviting, I'm sure that there is a whole spectrum in between of how this could have played out.
Thanks.
I could continue with questions if that's okay. With posing a question, or do you want to kind of hand it over to the chat?
Well, there are at least a dozen questions in the chat waiting for you.
I can always ask my own.
I have questions too. I'll just mention there's a first question for Gwendolyn from Demetrios about the relation between Thomas and Don and early glass shot pioneers like Warren Newcomb. But I think the essence of the question is that a lot of these players in the field have training in a variety of theatrical backgrounds. And so I'm paraphrasing a little about thinking of your comment about research. If other kinds of sources and other kinds of research are bringing the kind of people from non-filmic, theater backgrounds into it. So the specific question is about glass shot pioneers and the relation of Thomas with Don.
Right. That part of my paper, I hope I make clear that it's totally conjecture. We have a situation where all these people had Porter as a common relationship. They were all in New York at the same time, looking at similar conceptual approaches to the theater and to film. And I don't know. What I think is so wonderful is that these people from very different backgrounds, may have had these conversations. And I wish that there was something more specific I could say, yes, they did. And they did influence, but it's just something to throw out there. And maybe somebody, just as Tom Gunning threw out a challenge to me to find a missing link, maybe somebody will find a connection between these people at some time.
Question from Luciana Creo de Arroyo, sorry. For Celine, a question for Celine. You mention all women orchestras and the idea of women working as the chef d'orchestre. And she has found similar women orchestras and all women orchestras in Rio de Janeiro. So just a comment about women as silent film musicians.
Oui. Alors c'est vrai qu'en fait la question des femmes musiciennes est assez compliquée. Avant la Première Guerre mondiale, j'ai trouvé absolument aucune occurrence de femmes musiciennes qui travaillaient dans les salles de cinéma, encore moins chefs d'orchestre. C'est que après la Première Guerre mondiale, dans le courant des années 20, en consultant des livres de caisse et des contrats de travail de musiciens, que j'ai pu tomber sur quelques occurrences qui montraient qu'il y avait des femmes musiciennes dans les orchestres, mais jamais des chefs d'orchestre, jamais, absolument jamais. Et pourtant, je me suis attachée à chercher, hein, parce que je me suis posé la question aussi, où sont ces femmes ? Apparemment, elles étaient là, mais uniquement dans des... pas mentionnées, parce qu'en fait, elles avaient des places moins prestigieuses que des chefs d'orchestre. J'avais lu une suggestion d'un lecteur dans une revue qui se plaignait de la qualité de l'accompagnement musical en général et qui suggérait alors que l'orchestre soit uniquement composé de belles femmes pour pouvoir au moins pallier à la mauvaise qualité de la musique, faire plaisir aux yeux des spectateurs. Voilà. L'unique mention, très sexiste.
I will mention Céline, a follow-up also from Danielle, also working in Rio de Janeiro, but in this case, some musicians working in dance halls, working
in festivals.
So
they're
so Céline again, were some musicians also stars in other venues, other kinds of venues, restaurants, cafes, dance halls?
Oui, tout à fait. Ça, c'est quelque chose qu'on voit très bien, notamment dans le parcours du chef d'orchestre Paul Foss, parce que on a la chance d'avoir son curriculum vitae conservé à la Bibliothèque nationale de France. Et Paul Foss a commencé dans des brasseries à Marseille. Ensuite, il a été à Béziers, dans des restaurants. Et enfin, il est arrivé à Paris et il a commencé à ce moment-là à travailler dans les projections cinématographiques au Gaumont Palace. Après, c'est de la même manière, quand j'ai étudié le parcours des autres chefs d'orchestre, donc là, je n'avais pas leur curriculum vitae. Par contre, j'ai pu voir des mentions qui disaient qu'ils accompagnaient des galas mondains ou sinon qu'ils avaient rencontré beaucoup de succès lors d'un bal musette sur les bords de la Marne ou tout simplement qu'ils avaient... Il y en a beaucoup aussi, apparemment, qui jouaient dans les kiosques à musique qui ont eu énormément d'impact sur la vie musicale en France. Et donc oui, beaucoup de ces musiciens, en fait, qui ont travaillé dans tous ces différents espaces, ont finalement fini par se retrouver au cinéma.
Can I just make an input, because I'm checking and helping a little bit Paul Moore, and I just want to stress some answers. So Ian Christie just said to Céline and everyone that there were all women orchestras in cinemas in London around 1912, 1915, when the Italian spectacle films were in vogue. And he wrote about it, so we have this in a reference in how cinemas in London completed the boast about the quality of their orchestras. We also had this link made with yesterday's panel, because yesterday's panel has spoken of women orchestral leaders in Brazil. So just to make the connection, I think this was interesting. And I also have a question that is coming, because it was the first posted in the chat and then nobody answered. So it's also for Céline. I will just put it and then we can turn to Gwendolyn. Gwendolyn has also like a question from Tammy, I think. Perhaps you can find it, Paul, when I am just taking the one from Louisa Alvim. So Louisa Alvim just asked a question about the musical genre. That were, en fait, je peux la dire en français puisque Céline était en français. C'est la question de la part des genres musicaux. Quels genres sont le plus joués dans les cinémas entre 1906 et 1916? Est-ce que vous avez trouvé justement des indications par rapport aux genres, puisque Louisa Alvim travaille sur la musique classique et ce lien? Est-ce qu'à travers le filtre du genre, il y a peut-être un lien à faire?
Alors, sur la question du genre, malheureusement, j'ai uniquement les archives de Paul Foss qui peuvent me donner une petite idée de ce qui pouvait se passer entre 1913 et 1916, parce que lui, il a commencé à travailler au Gaumont Palace en 1911. Donc, entre 1911 et 1916. Parce qu'en fait, il est conservé à la Cinémathèque française les recueils des adaptations musicales que Paul Foss composait pour accompagner les films, qui est une source, une mine d'informations, et qui est voilà, y a énormément d'adaptations musicales, donc c'est pareil, c'est une source qui est un petit peu complexe à maîtriser. Et j'ai surtout, en fait, après, des pistes pour la pratique des autres chefs d'orchestre pour le courant des années 1920, parce que c'est à partir de ce moment-là qu'ils ont commencé à témoigner sur leur propre pratique dans la presse spécialisée. Donc, concernant Paul Foss, au début, il y a beaucoup de musique symphonique qui est utilisée. Et en fait, le répertoire que Paul Foss utilise est absolument hallucinant. Au début, il y a beaucoup de musique symphonique. Et au fur et à mesure, on voit qu'il commence à intégrer de la musique moderne, enfin, donc de la musique française qui lui est contemporaine, parfois aussi de la musique beaucoup plus populaire. Mais bon, après, je suis désolée parce que moi, là, sur ça, je peux surtout parler des années 1920, mais je trouve que c'est quelque chose qui est absolument fascinant. Les chefs d'orchestre, à partir du moment où ils commencent à prendre parole sur leur propre pratique, militent véritablement, en fait, pour en essayant d'expliquer à quel point ils sont là pour éduquer les foules à la musique, et plus particulièrement à la musique contemporaine française. Donc, il y a énormément, apparemment, on utilisait beaucoup du Debussy, par exemple, du Vincent d'Indy, du Berlioz, voilà, toute cette musique que les chefs d'orchestre avaient envie de valoriser, et parfois, du coup, des musiciens qui étaient connus à cette époque et qui sont totalement tombés dans l'oubli maintenant.
I have a question for Mario, thinking of genre as well. As you know, as my editor, I've been trying to write about Archie Shepherd, and part of his story is realistic sound effects and the use of the Bonamunter behind the screen with the trap drummers and the sound effects and that. And the earliest cases of it I've found are from the Spanish-American War, 1898. And so I was just thinking of your work on this paper. Is there maybe something about actually the travelogue or the war film that kind of lends itself to fictionalization narrations?
I would say that is nothing inherently in the genres themselves that would necessitate something of this sort. I mean, I don't see, for instance, why, you know, the same couldn't be accomplished if you had a particular presentational strategy to, let's say, you know, present a boxing. If you were to present it in terms of some kind of imagine yourself that you're there, that you're looking, you know, that you're, I don't know, receiving this punch or something like that. Probably what is best emphasized that it's really about the film itself, you know, may or may not be a prop for this fictional game of make believe. It's really about, you know, this kind of turns of phrase. You can show somebody a photograph of a castle and say, you know, this is a castle from Denmark in Elsinore or something like that. Or you could do the same thing but saying like, you know, oof, and imagine yourself walking through these corridors or something like that. And it's really a kind of this kind of turn of a phrase will suffice to from one, mode of reception to another.
And if I could just piggyback a question to Gwendolyn, in terms of theater practices and picture play practices before cinema, trap drummers and sound effects, is that a common thing in theatrical intermediality before film?
Well, there was usually a theater orchestra even in, you know, dramatic plays. And I'm not sure about sound effects, though, because I'll look that up, though, for you and see if I can, you know, send some information your way. Good question.
There's a question for Celine. There's a French version of it in the chat or in the Q&A. Were the BHVP programs collected systematically, or is it a limited amount for each room? Does the fund start before 1906?
Alors oui, ça c'est une question importante, effectivement. Non, tous les programmes ne sont pas collectés systématiquement à la Bibliothèque historique de la ville de Paris. C'est ça qui est compliqué avec le traitement de cette source, c'est que c'est vraiment très disparate. Alors, ils ont des programmes dès les débuts du cinéma à Paris, dès les projections du cinématographe Lumière. Et ça jusqu'à, je ne sais pas jusqu'à quand, mais en tout cas, c'est sûr, au-delà de 1929, parce que moi, je suis allée que jusqu'à cette année-là. Alors, ça va dépendre des salles. Certaines salles, certaines périodes, on va avoir énormément de programmes, et ensuite, on va avoir un grand trou, et puis plus tard, plein de programmes. Et puis après, il va y avoir des salles pour lesquelles on aura juste un ou deux programmes sur toute la période d'ouverture. Parce qu'en fait, ces programmes n'étaient pas collectés systématiquement par la mairie. C'est une source qui est très difficile déjà à conserver. Le papier se froisse, s'abîme et qui a été très facilement jeté. Donc finalement assez rare. Donc on se retrouve avec énormément de documents à recouper, mais finalement ça peut juste donner une tendance. On ne peut pas avoir une idée précise de ce que c'était. Mais déjà la tendance, c'est quelque chose quand à la base on n'a absolument aucune information.
There are a couple of last questions in the chat, but it's even 3 or 4 minutes past when I initially thought we would conclude. I would like to thank Domitor, thank Valentine, thank Tammy, and especially Celine, Mario, and Gwendolyn for doing an online panel in a remarkably good way.